Hello and welcome to PDFSupply.com. Today we're going to be testing an Allen Bradley PLC-5 processor. I have here an L20E. E because it's Ethernet, which is one of the things that we're going to, is this channel 2 that we're going to be testing and explain how to do that and configure it properly. The basic goal here is to get the processor into run mode and do what we have as a troubleshooting type test, how we do it here. It's being powered by a 1771 P4S power supply, and it's in a 1771 A1B 4-slot chassis, which is otherwise empty, because this is, again, just a test on the processor. So the first thing that we're going to do, now that I'm connected through channel 0 using this RS-232 to my computer, is go to RS Links. All right, now this is the software that connects the software and computer to the processor. It creates a communication path based on the type of driver that you use. So speaking of which, what we're going to do is, now that RS Links is open, I'm going to go to my configure drivers icon, which looks like an S-shaped computer cable with leads attached at each end. I'm going to click on that. And a second window pops open called configure drivers. So if you don't already have a driver configured, you can hit the drop-down menu and sort through and choose the appropriate one. Again, I'm using RS-232. And once you've chosen it, it's going to be in your configured drivers menu. Now, you can either double-click on the driver itself, or you can just simply hit configure on the right-hand side, that button. And a third window pops open. It says configure RS-232 devices with my type of device. And it's a cheat button we use, but before we employ anything here, you want to make sure that you have the right COM port selected for the COM port that you're using on your computer. I'm using COM1, so I've selected COM1, it's the appropriate choice. And I'm going to hit auto configure. So this cheat button goes through and it will sort out, this is why we call it cheat button, the baud rate, parity, stop bits, station number, that sort of thing, if you don't already have it set properly based on the settings of the processor. And once you're connected, it will say auto configuration successful. All right, and I've got that now. So I'm going to hit OK. And I'm going to close out my configure drivers window, and I'm going to keep RS Links open, but I'm going to reduce it so it's out of our way and make room for RS Logix 5. All right, so now that RS Logix 5 is open, I'm going to go to File, to New, and the Select Processor Type window opens up. What type of processor are we using? The platform, going from left to right, is Ethernet. It's four selections down. And the processor type is a PLC-520E for Ethernet. Now, to the right of that is Series, and below that is Revision. So if you do know your Series and Revision, now would be the time that you could put it in. If you don't know what it is, it's okay, because the RS Logix 5 will employ it for you. So go ahead and hit OK. Now you're faced with a brand new blank file. It's labeled Untitled. We don't have a name for it yet. We'll get into that in just a moment. Now the first thing you want to do, going back to this Ethernet port, is now that we're offline, but we are connected, the best thing we can do is to go to Channel Configuration, double-click on that, or right-click and open. Go to Channel 2, and this is where we can make the IP address so that we're able to ping that Ethernet card and make sure that that's working. So once you've opened that up, you're going to have a screen that says Ethernet Configuration. Below that is Network Configuration Type. And we want to select static. Now the default one is dynamic. You have to switch that yourself. So hit static. And then your IP address screen will open up. And it will allow you to edit or make changes to that so that you're able to ping it. And what I would recommend is to make sure that you're putting the IP address and a number that's high and far beyond whatever else you have on the network, so that you don't accidentally ping something else on the network that's been established already. Then on the right hand side, you can select the subnet mask. Once you're done, you can enter your way through, hit apply and okay. Excuse me, you can tab your way through, hit apply and okay. And once that's configured, we're gonna go to where it says offline in the top left hand side of the screen with the drop down menu. And we're gonna touch that drop down arrow and select download. So we're downloading a blank file that has a L20E processor with a configured IP address. That's it, nothing else. All right, now the first thing it might ask you is if you want to correct your revision in series, if that applies to you, so you want to say yes. Do you want the change, the difference in IP address? In this particular case, yes. Now you can, of course, if you already have an established IP address, you can, of course, use that. And at this time, I would also like to mention one other thing. This is very important. Very important for all processors to make sure that you have a good working battery, a tested battery that you're sure is working good, all processors. But in this particular case, the L20E, when you establish this IP address like I just have, it will sometimes ask you to power cycle. And if you power cycle, as you know, and the battery's not working, you'll likely lose that IP address during the test. So just please always make sure that you have a good working battery for these tests. All right, my download is complete and it's asking me to give the file a name. So this is just a PLC-520E test. I'll call it. And hit enter. Now the file has a name if I ever need to go back to it. And now that I've hit enter and everything's been accepted, I'm in program mode. So this is at this time you want to go to the actual physical processor, to the key, and go to remote program, hard run, as we call it, which isn't completely necessary, and then back to remote run. I typically keep the processors in remote run for tests like these. I don't necessarily need to use hard run. And now that it is in run mode, next thing I'm going to need is a transceiver device, okay? So if you guys probably have something that looks like this that connects to your channel 2 if you're using the Ethernet capabilities of this processor. All right, and the Ethernet cable goes in here and this attaches to the front of the processor. All right, once that's securely fitted to the processor, I'm going to take my Ethernet cable. I have a local Ethernet cable that I can plug in. And I'm going to go to my computer's command prompt screen. You could go to your start menu and open up accessories or all programs, and your command prompt will be within the accessories, okay? What you're going to ask command prompt to do with the blinking cursor is say ping space and then the address that you've given it. All right, well, I've given mine an address ending in 215, which is, again, a pretty high, far and beyond most of the numbers that are on our network. And I'm going to hit enter. All right, now immediately I have a response. I get four responses saying that this is being pinged and that the replies are immediate. So that tells me that this Ethernet card is communicating and working. What I will do at this time is I will unplug the transceiver and I'm going to ping it one more time. And I do this just to double check and make sure that I'm not actually pinging something on the network. So you hit the up arrow. It gives me the same address and then enter. And it's going off into nowhere. I'm not getting any replies at all. So I'm absolutely certain that I got replies from this device and no other device, because the second time around with it unplugged, I'm getting no response. So I'm satisfied that the Ethernet card is a good working Ethernet card. And the next thing I'm going to do, two other things here quickly. Go to processor status and double click on that. And on the in the menu there, the tab that says errors, I'm going to go to that, because if some sort of an error occurred when you guys were using it, or if there was some sort of a problem, it'll usually leave an error code or a fault code that tells you what the problem is. And if it's something that you is very, very minor, maybe you switched out a card to a newer revision and it set off an error or a fault, and you know that's just a very minor thing and you're aware of it, you could go ahead and hit clear major errors. And you might want to go through some of the other tabs like processor warning, program warning, channel warning, and just see that there's nothing out of the ordinary that's either selected or going on in there. All right, so mine's completely blank. I'm satisfied that that's okay. So the third part of the test would be perhaps to fill this with I/O modules, maybe put plastic or cardboard on the bottom and the top of this chassis. And I do that because I want to increase the heat. Put the processor under more of a load, more of an actual factory situation, and leave it running for 2 or 3 days. We usually do it over a weekend, is a good thing. Friday, Saturday, Sunday. We come in on Monday, and we feel that if the processor is still running and there's no error codes and it's perfect, then it's a good, healthy processor. If it fails, we'll usually go back to the processor status and try to find out what happened, see if we can do a little troubleshooting and find out why it's failing. And if it does fail on you, or if you guys have a problem that you just can't really figure out, this is something that we regularly repair here at PDF Supply. We offer exchange programs, new and remanufactured products, and same-day shipping. So if that is something that interests you or you need, please see us at pdfsupply.com.